This program contains material that could be distressing for some viewers.
Mad or bad? Evil or insane?
He was into sexual abuse and domination.
Was this all part of the thrill?
Hitchhikers, backpackers, young women. He saw something and he wanted to kill it. He was a serial killer.
30 years ago, in the remote Belanglo Forest, Australia's most infamous serial killer, Ivan Milat, murdered seven young hitchhikers.
Seven young backpackers.
Backpackers graveyard.
Now, a search for new victims is underway.
Even though we found seven, the question mark is, how many more?
Criminologist Dr. Xanthe Mallett and criminal psychologist Tim Watson-Munro are convinced Milat killed many others, including Karen Rowland, Diane Panaccio, Peter Letcher, and possibly South Coast teenagers Kay Doherty and Tony Kavanagh.
This is a horrifying list of potential victims.
The hunt for Ivan Milat's buried secrets.
I've no doubt there are more victims.
Inside the mind of a true psychopath.
Milat wanted to control everybody.
The strange rituals.
Stabbed in the back, shot in the head.
One person was decapitated.
The forbidden love.
An incestuous relationship.
You couldn't have been in the family without them. What's going on here?
The lucky survivors.
He said, okay, girls, which one of you wants it first?
Why he killed and killed again.
This is where things really did get started for him.
And an unforgettable twist.
Was the second person.
There's another serial killer out there.
As police launch a search for new clues.
This is going to shock a lot of people.
And the true scale of Ivan Milat's crimes.
This will change everything.
Is finally laid bare. Ivan Milat's killing ground is enormous. Almost 4,000 hectares of rugged bushland and dense pine forest. Searching for new burial sites here will be a huge challenge. But the investigation team has a secret weapon even the police don't have. A high-tech laser scanning system known as LIDAR. Dr. Yuri Shendrick will systematically scour the forest using a customised drone. It's the first time it's been used here.
So there's no disguise with this. If there's something there, we may find it.
Geographic profiler Doug McGregor has identified two high-priority areas for today's search.
You can just see them circled in red here. So these are the ones that we're going to use the LIDAR technology to investigate today.
All right, spinning.
Take off.
Taking off.
How is it going to cope with the actual foliage?
You can actually remove all the vegetation from your scan and see terrain only and see all the bumps, pits and depression.
Great.
In very high detail.
Back in the lab, Dr. Shendrick will create a detailed 3D image of the scanned zones, which can be sent to New South Wales Police for a new ground search.
All the bodies are within 3.5 kilometre radius of this point. But hopefully we'll find some more.
Exactly. If you look closely, you'll find it.
For years, Ivan Milat roamed the highways and back roads of New South Wales, picking up unsuspecting young travellers, raping, torturing, and murdering them. Just when the killing started is a secret Mallett took to his grave. But Tim and Xanthe are convinced it began way back in 1971 with Karen Rowland.
So this is the first time you've been here?
It is, in 50 years.
In 50 years, yeah, wow.
Steve Rowland's sister Karen was 20 years old and 5 months pregnant when she went missing in February 1971 after her car ran out of fuel. Her remains were found here 3 months later.
An elderly woman was out walking at the Air Disaster Memorial approximately 5 miles from Canberra City. As she was walking through the forest land, she discovered a handbag, and 12 feet away, the decomposed body of a woman.
Since then, there's been much speculation about her death, but no answers.
We've got the hypothesis that, you know, it could have potentially been suicide. That was one of the causes of death. We're 17 k's from where Karen's car was found. You know, this is where you would choose to end your life. That just doesn't make sense.
I don't buy that at all. No. I mean, you know, your car runs out of petrol, people hear screams, people see a woman running, and all of a sudden she comes here of her own volition and ends her life. I just think it's nonsense.
Impossible.
Only way to get here is if somebody brought her here.
Yeah. You know what strikes me? It's so Belanglo. The same pine trees, same sort of ambiance. You could hear a pin drop.
Like most serial killers, Ivan Mallett refined his technique, becoming more brazen and violent with each successive murder.
So we think that Karen was his first victim, and it seemed to be quite an improvised crime, not very experienced. And what the post-mortem showed, interestingly, in her case, if I show you the hyoid bone, which is in the center of the throat, that was actually broken. So if you were to strangle somebody, put your hands around their throat, that's why it's often snapped. So half of that was recovered, half wasn't, from the crime scene itself. And I've never seen that in anything other than a strangulation case. So if we look to the Belanglo victims, you know, we're seeing somebody who's really evolved in their MO, much more experienced than we see with Karen Rowland's offence.
Well, he's had years to hone his craft, to perfect his methodology.
Joanne Walters was actually stabbed 14 times, once in the neck, 4 times in the chest, and 9 times in the back. Mallett actually incapacitated a number of his victims by stabbing them through the vertebral column and severing their spinal cord.
Which would immobilise their legs, they'd be paralysed, they couldn't get away, and he could then play with them and torture them psychologically and physically. And, of course, in the case of Clark, he shot her 10 times in the head, maybe for target practice. This is the sort of psychopath we're dealing with.
I think all the murders during that period in the early 90s were conducted in the same manner. They all had a ritualistic element to them. One person was decapitated.
You can see a stab wound passing right through. If that was inflicted first, well, she would have been quite incapacitated.
Their bodies were found with cloth draped across their mouth. All the indications were that Mallett had, if you like, played with their bodies for some time. It wasn't just get them to the forest and kill them and shoot them or stab them. He'd obviously spent some time there. And given the fact that he'd paralyzed them by cutting their spinal cord, It could well have happened over a period of 24 hours or more. He may have taken that amount of time to actually deliver the final shot or the final stab wound.
How do you understand that? What's the mental makeup, the neurobiology of a psychopath who kills for no reason? Heredity? Circumstances of his upbringing? Or just an oddity? A one-off? A three-legged man? I don't know what makes his head like that, but it's extraordinary.
I believe that Milat was born evil. I really do. It's the classic example of nature and nurture. I think in his case, he was born bad, but also his family environment didn't help.
To get a deeper insight into what so fundamentally shaped Ivan Milat's twisted mind, you need to wind back the clock to the 1950s. To a very different Australia. When Milat was growing up in a poor, dysfunctional family on the outskirts of Sydney. Not far from where he would later abduct his victims.
Ivan had 13 brothers and sisters, so he came from a very large family. His parents were battlers. His dad was a migrant from Croatia. His mum was an Anglo. And they grew up tough, and Dad was a harsh disciplinarian. You know, when Dad was angry, they'd all just run, and people would see them shooting out the windows and the doors and anything to get away from Dad.
His father, I think, found Ivan and one of his brothers particularly naughty, because when Ivan was very young, like 7 or 8, his father would discipline him by taking him and his brother out in the backyard, getting them to lie face down, putting his foot on the back of their necks and pressing down, and then whipping them on the backs of their legs with a piece of 4x2 wood. And I think that that played a role in Ivan's, I use the term development loosely, as a human being. I think that it played a role in what Ivan Milat became as an adult.
His mother was much kinder to the kids. She never saw any wrong in her kids. She never saw any wrong in Ivan. She fussed over them, if you like, and she mollycoddled them to a certain extent. At a very early stage, Ivan started going off the rails. He went to a couple of schools. He would wag off school constantly. He would have fights with other kids.
Inside the police station, the sergeant explains the serious position they're in.
He was a difficult boy, there's no doubt about it. And it wasn't long before his criminal activity started escalating. I think he left school around about the age of 14. He was soon involved in breaking and entering, stealing cars, that sort of thing. And it wasn't long before he was in the court and behind bars.
I knew he was on a one-way trip. I knew that. It was just a matter of how long. He was going to kill somebody from the age of 10, I'd say. You know, it was built into him. He had a different psyche. He was a psychopath. And it just manifested itself with, you know, I can do anything.
By 1971, he graduated to committing armed robberies with his brother Mick. And that spree of armed robberies they did became a fairly serious chain of crimes.
Milat was really a series of contradictions. Neat, fastidious, polite to others, a control freak, loved his family, literally. And yet, would explode in rage. He was sadistic and cruel. And he was chameleon-like. He could blend into the community and get away with it until he was caught.
Coming up, Mallett's bizarre love life.
They did have an incestuous relationship.
What pushed him over the edge?
He didn't react well to this.
And a brave survivor.
He said, OK, girls, which one of you wants it first?
Ivan Mallett was an outsider with a deeply ingrained contempt for the law. He also had little regard for other social niceties, especially when it came to women. Mallett's pursuit of 16-year-old Karen Duck in 1975 was typical of his disdain for conventional values.
When Ivan Mallett first met Karen, who would later become his wife, she was 6 months pregnant by another man. It didn't really matter to Ivan. He thought, well, that was, you know, okay, so far as he was concerned. He didn't care whether he upset anybody. And there's no doubt about it, he did like women.
And no woman was off limits for Ivan.
Ivan Mallett had no moral compass. He had relationships with the wives of two of his brothers. He had a relationship with Wally Mallett's wife. He also had a very long relationship with Marilyn, Boris Mallett's wife. And that spanned a number of years, possibly as long as 20 years. And during that time, she conceived his child.
Much more disturbing than these affairs was Mallett's intimate relationship with his own sister.
Ivan's incestuous relationship with his sister Shirley is said to have continued over about a 40-year period. Their relationship was so strong that I think you couldn't have been in the family without sort of scratching your head saying, what's going on here?
While Ivan treated his illicit girlfriends with respect and affection, his marriage to Karen Duck was violent and abusive.
I think Ivan Mallett was a real Jekyll and Hyde character. He could be as nice as pie to some people and terrible to others. Certainly, as far as Karen's experience is concerned, he was dreadful. He was a controlling man. He was a monster in the way he treated her. But he could be incredibly kind, you know. Marilyn talked very kindly about him, and they had a very strong relationship, and she never saw that darker side of him at all.
The former Mrs. Mallett wept as she gave evidence for the prosecution. The ex-wife described him as gun crazy, a man who always carried a loaded pistol and would shoot at anything.
His wife Karen spoke of the incredible controlling violence that he exerted over her. It turned her into a nervous wreck. She was in such a state with him when he was about to come home from work. She knew that there couldn't be a leaf sitting on the front lawn. She had to mow the front lawn. She had to have the house perfectly tidy, dinner ready, just how he liked it.
Certainly Ivan Mallett would sexually abuse his wife, and he also would hit her too.
He felt the need to exert total control over her life. And I don't think this is entirely surprising, given what we know about him and what serial killers do, that the control is a huge part of the kick that they get.
It's no surprise with Mallett that every time he sustains emotional loss, typically through the breakdown of relationships with women, his killing starts. It's a means of emotional regulation. It's very typical with serial killers. Mallett uses power, control and sex to get some equilibrium back.
And specifically, we see that in 1971, way back when Karen Rowland was first killed. This was a particularly tumultuous year for Milat. His sister was killed in a car crash. His brother, Wally, was driving. And we know that affected Ivan Milat very significantly. So you can see how that could lead to him going out and finding his first victim.
Ivan was quite close to his younger sister, Margaret. It may just be a coincidence, but it was just weeks after that that Karen Rowland disappeared and was murdered in Canberra. Perhaps this is where things really did get started for him.
Just a few months later, Marilyn Milat, his sister-in-law, ends their affair, so loss of another woman in his life.
The best way to get back control was to control others.
Marilyn certainly felt that there was a link between her breaking up with Ivan and him going off the rails. When she broke up with him in early 1971, it was only a matter of weeks before Greta and Margaret were attacked.
Margaret Patterson and Margaret Pierce, or Greta as she became known, were two vulnerable young women. They met in Sydney while undergoing psychiatric treatment for being gay. The pair were hitchhiking to Melbourne when they were picked up by Ivan Milat on the Easter weekend.
A few hours into the journey, they noticed that suddenly they were on a gravel road, and he pulled over and basically told them that he was going to have sex with them, whether they liked it or not. One of the girls asked him, "Have you done this before?" And he said, "Yeah, I always come prepared."
He tied them up with rope. He produced knives. He said, "I'm going to slit your throat. I'm going to murder you. I'm going to kill you." And then one of the girls says, "If I let you have sex with me, will you let us live?" After Ivan had had his way with one of the young women, they drove off again.
Surprisingly, he then drove to a service station where he let them out. And they immediately reported it to the police.
Ivan then went on the run and remained on the run for 4 years before he was eventually captured and sent to trial.
I am very concerned in relation to him obtaining a fair trial.
Despite their seemingly strong case, in court, Milat's lawyer, John Marsden, successfully challenged the credibility of the two naive young women, making great play of the fact they were gay.
There was terrific bigotry in those days. Everyone was in the closet.
The girls weren't particularly good witnesses, and the solicitor, John Marsden, who was acting for Ivan, was able to play up the angle that they had confused sexuality, which back in those days was still considered to be a psychiatric illness.
Oh, well, he said that he expected to assault one of us or he was going to kill us.
Ivan himself gave evidence about it and said that it was all voluntary. The girl he actually raped, in her evidence, made a sort of partial confession that as a result of the pressure that was being put on her, she had agreed to the rape.
The jury certainly sided with Ivan, and they found him not guilty. It's almost unbelievable when you look at it now.
He beat the rape. It was dishonest. And John Marston had a lot of guilt. He was gay and he had a lot of remorse until the day he died over his helping Mallett at an early stage. It would have probably brought 10, 12, 14-year jail sentences. If he'd been in prison, his life would have been a different thing. He would have followed a different course.
One thing is certain, that Ivan learnt from that experience, that showing mercy was only going to get you into trouble. And perhaps it convinced him to take that next step.
Coming up, face to face with a psychopath.
There's something very odd about this guy.
The daring escape.
Run, Therese.
And Mallett's killing spree begins.
He saw something and he wanted to kill them.
It's the late 1970s, and Ivan Mallett is free to roam the highways, hunting for new prey. In 1977, he abducts two more hitchhikers just south of Sydney, not far from where he picked up Margaret and Greta.
My name's Therese Tran. I was a university student in Canberra back in the 70s. And I believe I was one of the lucky ones that escaped Ivan Mallett. I was a wild university student. Those days, everybody hitched. I used to hitch interstate, hitch between parties, hitch in the middle of the night, and it felt very safe. It was another one of those wild university weekends where this friend of mine, Mary, and I decided to go to Sydney for a party on the Saturday night. So we hitched up, had a wonderful time, and on the Sunday, we had to hitch back. We stood there for quite a while, and eventually, this car stopped. And this guy said, "Where are you going?" And we said, "Oh, we need to hitch a ride to Canberra." And he said, "That's fine, hop in." So we did. Mary got in front and I got in the back. So we drove for a while and the conversation revolved about various things like his love for shooting and guns and all that. Once he found out that I came from Vietnam, he was very focused on talking about war. Bombs, the shooting. Did you see people die? There was a real fascination about death and war. We got to Mittagong, went down the Hume Highway, and at one stage, he took a right-hand turn, and it was tarred for a certain distance, then it became a dirt track road. At that stage, Mary said, "Where are you going? Well, you know, this isn't the road to Canberra. We're going, you should be going straight down the Hume Highway." So, no, it's fine. Haven't you ever been to Canberra via this way? It's a very scenic route. I don't remember how long it took, but he turned left onto one of those, you know, the clearings where there are logs. And he stopped there. I do remember Mary turning around saying, "What are you doing?" You know, and he said, "Well, I have to stop. Mother Nature calls." He opened the car, got out, at which point my friend turned around. She said, "Okay, there's something very odd. Get ready. If anything happens, I'll just shout, run, and we just hit the ditch." He came back to the car and turned around and said, Okay, girls, which one of you wants it first? He reached over to grab Mary around her shoulders, and she, being a much bigger girl than me, like quite strong, just went whack and said, run, Therese. And all I remember was just running down towards the ditch and then just hiding behind a bush. It's like as if everything slows down. You're like an animal in the bush, just listening. Everything is heightened and you hear every sound. Barely breathing, just being like animals. You're being hunted, so that's how you behave. We did feel very scared. I heard the car starting and going towards the right and then stopping. And I was thinking, oh my God, you know, he's gonna go search for us. But he didn't. The car started again and the sound disappeared. So we went back to the highway. When we got to the highway, we thought, well, what are we gonna do? We just still don't have the money to get back. So we had to hitch again all the way back to Canberra. After that, neither of us hitched again. We just carried on with life as usual. Neither of us thought of reporting it. It was just considered to be, you know, an unfortunate incident that happened in your life. And, you know, you don't think that you could possibly have been killed. I certainly didn't think, look, there's someone who's a serial killer. I really just forgot about it until 20 years later when the bodies were found in Belanglo State Forest.
On the weekend, the bodies of Carolyn Clark and Joanne Walters were found in bush graves near the New South Wales Southern Highlands.
I think I was one of the lucky ones that got away. And in fact, when I had to go to the police station, one of the officers said, we believe you girls were a practice run. So, you know, maybe I think we were. We were just lucky, incredibly lucky.
Still to come.
He's a predator.
Horror in Belanglo.
Milat wanted to control everybody.
As Milat's murders escalate.
Tied to a tree and used as target practice.
Ivan Milat has let two more women slip through his grasp. But it's only a matter of time before he strikes again. His urge to rape and kill triggered by more emotional turmoil.
The next big trauma in his life comes in 1987, in February, when Karen Duck, his wife, leaves him. And it's later that same year, in November, that Peter Letcher is murdered.
There's a strong correlation, once again, between emotional loss, in this case, the breakdown of his marriage, and him then acting out by abducting and killing people quite brutally. I mean, the nature of his abductions and the way that he kills these people clearly speaks to unbridled rage.
When his marriage to Karen broke down, Ivan was shattered, absolutely shattered. All he could say is, I can't believe it. I just can't believe it. He said, I thought I treated her well, but I just can't believe it. He was just a very shattered, broken man.
In this rare recording of Milat speaking from prison to his sister-in-law, Caroline, he reveals just how deeply it affected him.
So was it a particularly hard time in your life?
Traumatic, I suppose. It's like a different family, I suppose. That's how it struck me. Yeah, it was sort of a loss. I loved her, and obviously she didn't love me or whatever. I had no idea. You know, I got surprised my life, so to speak.
Karen ran out on Ivan on Valentine's Day 1987. He didn't react well to this. He went looking for her and was angry. About 9 months later, the first of the probable unsolved Mallett murders of Peter Letcher occurred in November 1987. And then exactly 1 year after she left him on Valentine's Day 1988, he burnt down the garage of her parents.
1988, he's single again, so he resumes his affair with Marilyn Mallett.
Yes, his sister-in-law, although it didn't last that long, just a couple of years, and again ended in turmoil.
That was just before the backpacker murders started, and Marilyn couldn't help thinking that perhaps their relationship and the heartbreak of the breakup had contributed in some way.
In July 1989, Karen Duck divorces Mallett, and then later that year, in December, James Gibson and Deborah Everest are murdered.
He's clearly escalating at this point. This time he has two victims. 1991, there's more killings. There's Diane Panaccio, who's abducted and murdered, Simone Schmidl and murdered, and it's clear that his modus is now well established. Whenever he has a problem in his life, he seems to hit the road, abduct people and kill them.
Later that same year, in December, Anya Havshid and Gabor Nugabar were murdered. And in 1992, Joanne Walters and Caroline Clark were murdered.
And again, a duo. They're hitchhiking, he takes them both, and they're brutally murdered. Stabbed, and one was shot 10 times in the head. The crimes are becoming ritualistic, well entrenched. He's got his methodology down pat, and he enjoys killing people, and why not two? He can control them both, double the pleasure, and he can come back to the crime scene and savor his evil when they're dead. Brutally evil and destructive behavior.
There's an immense amount of rage shown in what he did to the victims.
We did find four stab wounds on the left side of the chest. And there's another one here, which is very similar. And you can see the stab wound coming down this far, then the rest of the rib is just split from that.
They were all uniformly stabbed around that spinal region. And that speaks of his desire to not just kill them, but to control them in a totally helpless state in those minutes before the life ebbed out of them.
He's always been somebody who I think needs to be in control. Mallett wanted to control everybody, and he clearly relished the control that he had over all the young people he came into contact with.
This cloth was around on the outside of his mouth, and you can see that it's in the form of a gag tied from behind, and it was this part that was around the outside of his mouth at the scene.
The strange thing about Ivan Mallett was that he really did overdo it when it came to the way he inflicted injuries on his victims. He used far more bullets than was necessary to kill people. He used far more stab wounds than was necessary to kill people. Now, why did he do that? Did he want them to linger? Was this all part of the thrill that he got when he carried out his crimes? The terror that he inflicted on these people was just indescribable, and what they went through in their final minutes and seconds would have been hell on earth.
He killed for no reason. But no reason at all with Mallett. randomly chosen young people walking down a highway. He wanted to kill them. I don't even think it was sexual gratification. I think it was having another person's life in his hand and stabbing them, but I can't work out why you would do it. He just saw people as moving objects and probably enjoyed their agony.
It's the early 1990s, and Ivan Milat is at the height of his murder spree. In the sanctuary of his remote killing ground, he dispatches his victims with unspeakable cruelty. Milat's not only prolonging their suffering, savouring every last moment, he's also taking souvenirs. He might even have kept the skull of German backpacker Anya Hubschied after decapitating her.
Police found a lot of souvenirs in Milat's possession. This is not uncommon. Serial killers, as you know, often take souvenirs for various reasons.
He gathered together a vast array of material that belonged to the backpackers. Camping equipment, tents, mattresses, cameras, money, foreign currency.
And not only did he take them, but he then gave them to his family members. It's almost like he's challenging the police to figure out what he's done.
Of all the souvenirs that he took, the most chilling was probably the Benetton top of Carolyn Clark.
There was a photograph of Milat's girlfriend wearing a Benetton top, which was exactly the same as a photograph of Caroline, which is in our sitting room every day.
Chelinda Hughes has stuck by Ivan Milat. Today she was giving evidence about why at Milat's home police found a photograph of her wearing a green and white Benetton top.
We know that he took it and gave it to his girlfriend, Chelinda Hughes. Took a photo of her with that on.
He's getting off on the fact that he gets to see his girlfriend wearing the jumper of a dead girl.
That was one of the things that put him away. It was Caroline's contribution.
What the family actually thought about these gifts, you can only wonder.
It was, to say the least, a very unusual family. And what you'd say is that with Ivan giving members of the family this much property, you'd think the family's got to be saying, thanks, that was very nice. But where did he get it?
I'm mindful of that great expression. He killed, and having killed for no reason, he couldn't live with it, so he stole from the dead body.
Just as Milat's souvenirs provided crucial evidence in the Belanglo killings, belongings stolen from Diane Panaccio and Karen Rowland could link him to their murders too. Diane's gold chain, earrings and house keys were almost certainly souvenired by her killer.
When they got Milat, that they did check his house for the necklace and keys, but nothing was found.
In Karen's case, a bracelet bought at the Canberra show just hours before she died might provide a breakthrough.
So these are the bracelets, similar to what you believe that Karen actually bought at the fair.
That's right.
And she got it actually engraved at the show?
It was, so engraved with Lynette.
So this is a gift?
A gift for Lynette, yep. Pomeroy.
Yeah.
And Lynette never received the bracelet, was never found in a vehicle, wasn't found at home.
Potentially the murderer
took that item with them.
It could be a souvenir, a memento. Serial killers are known to do this. Or it may have been given to somebody who's a friend or family. It may still be in their possession. And this might be something that triggers old memories in a context where they feel safe and now to speak about it.
So basically, if somebody can identify this bracelet or a similar bracelet to this with Lynette engraved on it, that could be absolutely crucial to you.
I think for us, that's our link to the past. Yeah. That is our key piece of evidence.
Despite relentless pressure from her family, it's been decades since Keren's murder was actively investigated. But our reinvestigation of the case has finally forced the hand of federal police. In a carefully orchestrated operation, they recently returned to the crime scene at Fairbairn Pine Plantation to search for Keren's missing bracelet.
We recognise that it has been a long time, 50 years. And we're now conducting a search with equipment that was not available in the 1970s.
The search uncovered nothing. But Steve Rowland hasn't given up hope.
There is someone, or has been someone out there, that took Keren and her baby's life. It just didn't happen. It wasn't something that happened on its own. And somebody somewhere does know. And that was what we'd really want to find out.
Ivan Milat was a brazen serial killer. At least three times, he murdered two victims in one hit.
Gabor Neugebauer and Anya Hamshig were murdered.
Were found scattered through the Belanglo State Forest.
It's one of the great mysteries of the Milat case. Two strong young people against one man doesn't add up. Did Milat work alone? Was there a second killer?
When searchers came upon the headless body of German Anya Hubschied, it was covered with logs, so heavy it took more than three policemen to lift them.
I'm in two minds, because I think Milat was a very powerful man. He was well armed with knives, revolvers, rope. When he was dealing with the girls, Caroline and Joanne, it was probably fairly easy for him. So that leads one to think that maybe he was a solo.
Ivan acted alone, and I've got no doubt in that. Ivan saw himself as the person in control. And he went about it in a way which gave him that control. When it came to actually exercising authority over them, he either pulled a gun or pulled a knife. If you want additional support that Ivan was on his own, you only have to look at the people that escaped Ivan. That is the two girls in 1971 and the other Paul Onions.
This English backpacker has identified Milat as the man who offered him a lift, drove him south along the Hume Highway, almost to the turnoff to the Belanglo State Forest, and pulled a gun on him.
On both those occasions, Ivan was on his own.
But then he had to deal with the German couple, and the young man was a big, hefty chap, 6'5" or 6", and it's surprising that he took them on, unless he was just so cocksure of himself that he knew he could.
How could one man overpower two people, particularly two young people who are quite strong? The answer to that, of course, was that he may well have got one of the parties to tie up the other party. And once the other party was tied up, then he could tie up the other person.
We know that he attacked Paul Onions alone. We know that in the days after the disappearance of Anya Habschied and Gabor Neugebauer, that he had a bullet hole replaced in the front passenger seat of his car, as though he'd shot from the driver's seat through the hip region of whoever was sitting in the passenger seat and out the door. That speaks of somebody who is trying to control people from the driver's seat.
I think the other thing that really supports the fact that he acted alone is that he gave family equipment that had been taken from the backpackers, and there was no suggestion from any member of the family that anyone else in the family had been a contributor to giving and sharing the backpacker equipment.
Richard Mallett denied telling the same workmate they hadn't found all the bodies.
Look, all I can point to is that at the end of the trial, Justice David Hunt, he thought it was very likely that there was a second person.
In his sentencing, Justice Hunt said he did not believe Mallett had acted alone.
In those cases where there were two backpackers who had been abducted, he thought there was a likelihood that there was a second person with Ivan to assist. And at one of the death scenes in the forest where Anya Habschied and Gabor Neugebauer had been murdered, there were two guns that had been used. So it was strongly suggestive of two people.
You know, there's the possibility that whoever was the shooter might not have been Ivan, that Ivan might have been the stabber, and there was a shooter was somebody different, somebody who smoked cigarettes.
Cigarettes and drink bottles were found at the scene of the crime, quite near the bodies of James Gibson and Deborah Everest, the two Australians. Two empty whiskey bottles and cigarette butts. Now, we know for certain that Ivan didn't smoke, and he didn't drink either.
Whoever shot Carolyn Clark was a smoker. There was a small circle of butts placed out on the ground near where the shells from the .22 were falling out of the gun.
That does suggest that Ivan wasn't alone. Picking up two people and threatening them and overpowering them might well have intensified the experience for Ivan Mallett, might have given him a greater sort of sadistic pleasure, if you like. It might well have given him greater scope for him to carry out his evil intent and to perform all manner of devious acts.
What's your theory, Xanthe? Do you think he killed alone or is he with others? I think he acted alone.
All of the evidence I've seen points to the fact that he acted alone.
The intriguing question that flows from that, of course, is that cigarette butts and empty alcohol tins and bottles were found. He was known to be a non-drinker. So that raises a number of possibilities. Did he have an alternate ego? Like Jekyll and Hyde. So meticulous Ivan became careless drinking, smoking Ivan as part of his relaxation, as part of the ritual. Or was he more Machiavellian, leaving this evidence quite deliberately to put people off the scent?
And the third option is actually that he got the victims to drink and smoke as part of his ritual behaviour.
People wonder how he could have acted alone and controlled two people as victims. My answer is simple. Fear is a very powerful motivator, particularly if the person has a firearm.
Oh, I agree. I think fear of a gun can certainly be a powerful reason to follow direction. So that also means that he could have been responsible for the murders of Kay Doherty and Tony Kavanagh.
The theory about Ivan Milat, his name in our household was common, was popular for the wrong reasons, was often spoke about. My gut feeling, I've got an open mind, and always have had. So it's hard for me to rule anything out. It's hard for me to believe anything. But my gut feeling back then, it made me sick.
Criminal investigators Tim Watson-Munro and Dr. Xanthe Mallett have unearthed five potential new victims of serial killer Ivan Milat. Now they've uncovered another strong case.
It's one of the most intriguing cases that I've come across. The whole thing is just quite an extraordinary tale. There was a family from a little place called Cranback, which is around about 2.5 hours north of Newcastle, who had decided to go to Colwarrick State Forest and search for some garden mulch for their home. And while they were collecting that garden mulch, they came across a human skull. Authorities were alerted to it and the crime scene was established. And over the course of the next couple of days, forensic police and detectives sifted through the dirt looking for the remains. It was fairly obvious from the start that police had a murder investigation on their hands. What was found at the scene was some jewellery, a lot of bangles, which initially pointed to police thinking that the body belonged to a young woman. Unfortunately, the autopsy done by the pathologist in Sydney put this case back more than a decade. The pathologist found that the remains belonged to a young male, probably aged between 16 and 19, and probably of Asian descent. The leads really dried up very quickly.
Ten years later, local detectives decided to revisit the case, requesting a fresh autopsy on the mysterious body in the bush.
To everyone's disbelief, the pathologist came back and said the remains were that of a young female. Police were flabbergasted. They'd lost 10 years in investigation, but at least now they thought they may finally get to the bottom of it. You can't find the murderer until you know who the victim is. So investigators went to an expert at Sydney University who was an expert in facial reconstruction, and they actually were able to reconstruct the face from the skull found at the scene to give a picture of who this person might be. So the police were really excited, you know, they finally had a face that they could put out to the public and say, you know, who is this person? But nobody came forward.
It was another 3 years before local teenager Dylan Walsh started looking into the case and saw striking similarities to his missing aunt.
Dylan went to his family and said, I might have found what happened to Auntie Susan. And they went straight to the police. And within a couple of weeks, had taken a DNA sample from Susan's mum. A few weeks after that, had finally confirmed that the remains belonged to Susan Osnood. Susan was last seen on the 2nd of October, 1986. She had spent the day celebrating her brother Robert's birthday before Robert had dropped Susan off outside the Stag and Hunter Hotel at Mayfield, but she did tell Robert that she was heading away and probably hitchhiking north. Her mother reported Susan missing a few days after she was last seen. They never ever gave up hope that Susan was still alive and that one day she would actually come home. For 17 years, they wondered what had happened to Susan. All of a sudden, they're told that Susan's remains had been in a box the entire time. Their hopes that she was coming back were obviously dashed, but now they had questions of what had happened to her and who was responsible for it.
I've got mixed feelings. Part of me is angry. Part of me is relieved.
The cause of death was almost certain: blows to the head. Obviously with the fractures to the skull. Police still unclear whether Susan would have been killed at the scene or whether she would have been killed somewhere else and then her body dumped. Susan's body was found in Warwick State Forest in a place, although only a few hundred metres from the Pacific Highway. If you knew the area and wanted to discard a body, it was a good place to do so. It didn't appear that there was any gravesite. The body had been just discarded. A name that continued to crop up in 2003 and 4 was Ivan Milat. Susan Eisenhood was known to hitchhike. She was actually probably going to hitchhike that day north. Ivan Milat was known to have worked in the Newcastle area in the 70s and the 80s as part of road gangs. And there was also anecdotal evidence that he'd worked further north towards Taree, where Susan's body was found.
The case of Susan Eisenhood takes the tally of likely Milat victims to 6.
The disappearance and murder of Susan Eisenhood bears many similarities to the MO of Ivan Milat. She disappears off a major arterial road, the Pacific Highway, proximal to Newcastle, and she's found in dense forest.
Very similar, obviously, to Belanglo. And we also know that there were a number of pieces of jewellery that were found scattered among her remains, which were distributed around the forest. But what we don't know is if anything was actually taken as a memento.
We know Milat is working in the area. He's driving up and down the Pacific Highway, a marauding serial killer. He sees a vulnerable hitchhiker. He picks her up, he kills her, and he dumps her close to the highway.
But it's not long after that that he finds a much more convenient killing field much closer to home.
Coming up, the veil is finally lifted on Belanglo.
It's like having X-ray vision.
In the hunt for fresh burial sites.
You can actually see potential areas for a search.
Two weeks ago, Dr. Yuri Shendrick scanned Belanglo State Forest, looking for sites where Ivan Milat could have hidden other bodies. He searched two 15-hectare zones using laser technology called LIDAR. The data has now been processed into a 3D image of the forest.
This is the data that we collected, and this is site number one, which we scanned using a LIDAR sensor. So you can see this level of detail colored in different colors. basically red colors, higher elevation, blue, green colors, lower elevation. With any other imaging technology, you can't really get that level of detail. That's why LiDAR is really powerful.
Site 1 was identified as a high priority for scanning because it's at the far end of a fire trail, one of Mallett's favoured killing zones.
What we're actually looking for are where you have the major fire trails. Mallett used those for vehicle access to get the victims in. He then wanted a smaller trail to get off that main track and then a clearing. And those are the kind of sites that he was targeting so he could spend time with his victims as well as going back later.
Right, so this is one of the main benefits of LiDAR. You can actually remove a whole vegetation and see what's happening underneath. You can see terrain and all the bumps and pits in very high detail. And that's what we were able to capture with LiDAR very, very nicely. You can actually see all the trails that are known and possibly not known that are potential areas for a search.
It's like having X-ray vision, really.
Exactly.
It's amazing technology.
Yeah, so here you can see site number 2, which is roughly the same size. And again, it's heavily vegetated site and with a main trail.
The second scan site is close to where Caroline Clark and Joanne Walters' bodies were found.
Is that a fire trail or a walking trail there?
So this is a fire trail which you can access by car, and that's exactly how we got to the site. If you follow this trail, you can
it's another one.
Those tiny trails that extend from the main one, which you can only access on foot.
Yeah, and you would never see that through this bush
Look
cover.
How dense it is.
Yeah.
If I were to direct people to check certain spots, those would be probably the high priority areas, those trails that go off the main track.
And actually then, when you get a break in the canopy, you can actually see that. So we've got the walking trail, and then here we appear to have an open area.
There you go. Yes, it's a flat area, and that's probably a good stopover. Yeah. I would definitely prioritize those kind of areas for search.
Both site scans reveal unusual depressions in the terrain and hidden clearings that could be fresh killing fields for Ivan Mallett.
He would have walked along this trail here, down to here, an open area, killed his victims, and then had time to sit back and savour his brutality.
Could Kay Doherty and Tony Kavanagh be here as well? These cutting-edge images of Belanglo Forest will now be sent to New South Wales Police. It could be the breakthrough needed to solve this case. Still to come, the serial killer turned celebrity.
He liked being a star.
Wielding his power until the very end.
That was Mallett still being in control.
And a final twist.
There are other Ivan Malletts out there.
When Ivan Mallett was arrested for killing the 7 backpackers, his notoriety earned him a twisted celebrity status around the world.
Police in Australia.
Australische Polizei hat in einem
murder of 7 backpackers, including 2 British girls.
I've never met anyone like Ivan Mallett. He just didn't respond like other humans.
High-profile criminal lawyer Chris Murphy saw firsthand how Mallett revelled in his newfound infamy.
He was arrested for his murders on the 22nd of May, 1994. On the 29th of May, 1994, he sent a message for me to go out and see him. I had the largest criminal practice in New South Wales, probably Australia at the time. We got calls all the time to visit people in jail. He'd asked for me And it was out of extreme curiosity that I wanted to meet Ivan Milat. I've been involved in hundreds of homicides, but I've never dealt with a person who's killed for no reason. I sat in the visitor's waiting room. Came walking down the hall. Like a string puppet with his arms jangling. And I could pick that prison persona, usually associated with long-time inmates who have some sort of status, and he had a status of his own in that jail as a homicidal maniac. He was a bit proud of who he was. I could sense that. Young prisoners would whisper and look, there's Ivan Milat. He liked being a star among prisoners. What an odd claim. What an odd claim to a position in life or achievement, that you move into a world of people who do bad things and you're at the top of the tree. The first thing I noticed with Ivan Milat is that there was no emotional response to stimuli in conversation. If I told you a joke, you might laugh. He just sat there until I laughed. If I said this was serious, you might frown. But unless I frowned as well, he didn't frown. He just wasn't responding. He just didn't know how to behave as a human. He said, I would like you to represent me. I said, well, I don't think I want to do that. I've represented thousands of people. I have appeared for members of parliament and movie stars, celebrities and beggars. I have been in practice since 1972, and I've fought with the full fibre of my being for everyone who's been wrongly charged. Ivan Milat was hopelessly guilty of a series of shocking homicides. I couldn't overcome anything in myself that could ever let me use my powers in a situation like that. And I couldn't live with myself if I got Ivan Milat off.
Milat spent 23 years in prison for the backpacker murders. Despite the mountain of evidence against him, he refused to confess.
A lot of people who are clearly guilty of horrendous crimes maintain their innocence to the end. One of the most common reasons is to maintain credibility with the few people who are still supporting them out in the real world. So in Ivan's case, it was members of his family. And I think in order to maintain credibility with them, he maintained his innocence to the end.
Milat exposed one small chink in his armour when he was compared to the notorious underworld killer, Neddy Smith.
Milat was walking past a group of prisoners, and one said to him, who's killed more people, you or Neddy Smith? And he said, we could have a good weekend away hunting together. He was a serial killer without morality or care. And he had a persona. And in an odd, smug way, in the devil's playground, he clung to it.
He also reportedly divulged his secrets to his mother when she was dying.
When Margaret Milat went to visit her son, she knew she didn't have long to go, and she went to visit him in Supermax. And she came out looking a bit shaken, and one of her younger sons, George, asked her what was wrong. Had she been told something she didn't want to hear? And she said yes.
George said to her, did he say anything to you? What did he say? Did he say that he'd done it? And Margaret said, Yes, he did, or words to that effect. And that was the only time, if it's true, that was the only time that Ivan Milat confessed to his guilt.
He wasn't so forthcoming with police. They tried desperately to extract confessions about all his suspected victims, including missing girls Tony Kavanagh and Kay Doherty.
The detectives that were on our case, they'd actually gone to Goulburn Jail. They told me that he was the most conniving, cunning, biggest liar they had ever spoke to.
Even when Milat was days away from dying in 2019, he continued to wield power over police and the victims' families.
Some people thought that Ivan Milat might confess on his deathbed, but that never happened. Never happened. And the police made numerous visits to his deathbed in hospital and in the prison wing at the Long Bay Jail. He was only days away from succumbing to cancer. And he would always say, "I know nothing about it, mate. You can hold a blowtorch to my eyes, and I'm not going to say anything." He was determined not to give anything away at all, or to admit any kind of guilt.
I think that was Milat still being in control in his own mind. That, you know, he'd got a secret that everybody else wanted, and he wasn't going to tell anybody.
I think Ivan maintained his innocence right to the end because he thought he was still in charge. He still possessed stuff that you wanted. I think he saw that as a way of maintaining the fact in his mind that he was the boss, he was in control.
It's the great question of law, mad or bad. Do we mark him evil or insane? He certainly was not a tiger that you'd want loose in the public arena.
The evidence in the Belanglo killings was overwhelming. But the infamous name of Ivan Milat has now been linked to more than 20 other murders right up the east coast of Australia.
Milat was a highway killer. He was marauding and cruising up and down the Hume Highway, abducting and killing people. We suspect also that he was driving up and down the Pacific Highway and killing people as well.
From Canberra, the nation's capital, to far north Queensland, it's a frightening roll call of unsolved deaths and disappearances dating back to the early 1970s.
There have been a lot of backpackers who have disappeared without trace. A fair number of those backpackers were probably also his victims.
Over the past year, Tim Watson-Munro and Dr. Xanthe Mallett have been working to discover just how many of these young hitchhikers were victims of Australia's most notorious serial killer.
People were vanishing then, people were being killed, but it just wasn't on the news as much.
Nobody joined the dots, but he had a free hand at it for a fair while.
Time, indifference, and incompetence have meant the trail has gone cold in some of the cases.
Michelle Pope and Stephen Lapthorne.
We just don't know enough about these two to rule them in strongly, so I think we need to put them aside.
And place and circumstance have ruled out others.
I also don't think Milat's responsible for Robin Hoynville Bertram or Anita Cunningham in North Queensland because it's just too far out of his hunting zone.
That leaves six strong possibilities.
Let's take a look at our shortlist.
Yep, I think we should start with Kay Doherty and Tony Kavanagh.
Schoolgirls Kay Doherty and Tony Kavanagh went missing from the south coast town of Warilla in 1979.
It was right here at this bus stop, opposite the Warilla Grove shopping centre, And Mallett was known to be working in this area at the time.
This is literally the last place they were ever seen alive.
Yes. They disappeared.
More than 40 years later, their bodies have not been found.
I knew something wasn't right. And I knew I wasn't going to see my twin sister again. I really knew that.
So in terms of why we have included them in our shortlist, they fit the victim profile and they are within the geographical range of Belanglo. However, without the deposition site, and really that is Malat's MO, isn't it? It's all about that deposition site and what he does with his victims at those locations. So I don't think we can rule them out, but they're not the strongest likely Malat victims for me.
Well, having reviewed all the evidence, I agree with you.
So I think we should next consider Susan Eisenhood.
22-year-old Susan Eisenhood went missing from Newcastle in 1986. The body was found in a forest 2 hours north along the Pacific Highway.
The cause of death was almost certain, blows to the head. It didn't appear that there was any grave site. The body had been just discarded. Mallett. He's an obvious suspect and an obvious strong suspect to this day.
In my view, a much stronger example of Mallett. The modus operandi fits with his. She's found in dense forest off a major arterial highway, the Pacific Highway, in a shallow grave. I would definitely rule her in as a Mallett victim.
Certainly, although she's probably not at the top of the list for me. For that, we should look at Peter Letcher.
Peter Letcher was murdered in 1987, just before the Belanglo killings began.
It did have similarities to the backpackers.
He'd been stabbed in the back, he'd been shot in the head.
They were 22 bullets.
Exactly like seven bodies that we found in the Belanglo forest.
This one's hard to go past.
In my view, a very strong case. I think Mallett definitely did it. The evidence points to him, the gun casings, the modus operandi, and his hitchhiking along a major arterial highway, which was the Great Western Highway, prior to being murdered.
Yeah, for me, ever since I started looking at Mallett, I've always considered him the eighth Mallett victim. I'm also sure that Mallett is responsible for Peter's death. Next individual we have to consider is Diane Panaccio.
Diane Panaccio went missing in 1991 during Mallett's Belanglo killing spree. She was 29 years old and had a 2-year-old son.
So this is the last place she was seen alive.
She's vulnerable, she's on her own. For a predator, that's ideal.
They located the remains under a tree stump and covered in pine needles.
We're told that she was strangled and stabbed.
Again, a very strong likelihood that it's Mallett. She disappears in Bungendore. It's suggested that Mallett was drinking at the Bungendore Hotel when she was there. He was known to be working in the area at the time. And of course, the deposition sites are virtually identical to the others.
Yeah, I hadn't really considered Diane Panaccio as a likely Mallett victim until we went actually out to the scene. For me, I think Diane Panaccio has to be right up there as a likely Mallett victim. Then, of course, there's Karen Rowland.
Karen Rowland was just 20 and 5 months pregnant when she was abducted and murdered in Canberra back in 1971.
Witnesses suggest they've seen a dark-coloured car. A young girl running from the car. Is there any chance that that was Ivan Mallett's car?
I can give a lot of reasons as to why it could be him. I can't find an answer as to why it isn't him.
Tell me why it can't be Ivan Mallett.
From the very beginning, I was very sure that she was a victim of Mallett, probably his first victim. The modus operandi, I think it was an opportunistic crime. The deposition site, identical really to Belanglo. she's strangled, and I think that that's where he started to get the lust to kill others.
Yep, totally agree. I've been working with the Rowland family for probably a couple of years now to try and move the case forward, and I really think that if we hadn't gone down this route to reinvestigate it, then the AFP may not be looking at it now. So that's a really positive step forward, and I genuinely believe that this case could now be solved.
I do too.
But what of the other victims along Australia's east coast, whose deaths and disappearances remain shrouded in mystery?
All of these are less likely to be Milat's victims, which means there's another serial killer out there.
Or several, so someone else could have been preying on young, vulnerable backpackers in the 70s and 80s.
Maybe you could argue that Ivan Milat wasn't a very good serial killer because he got caught. I suspect that most of them don't.
I think that we're a bit naive in thinking that Ivan Milat was a one-off case. If you look at the statistics, there were backpackers disappearing at fairly regular intervals. And my own view is that there are other Ivan Milats out there.
Ivan Milat's murders left at least seven families forever fractured. And the repercussions of his crimes continue to reverberate around the world.
The number of people who were affected by these crimes would go into hundreds. Not just the parents and the close relatives of the victims, but friends of the victims. Ivan Milat's actions had affected hundreds of lives, if not thousands of lives.
Tim and Xanthe believe the new evidence uncovered during their 12-month investigation will help the six victims' families, who are simply seeking justice.
So what we should do now is take all of the information that we've collated and present that to police.
These cases are potentially solvable.
Yep, and after all these years, these families deserve answers.
The impact on the family has been immense. I don't know of many other detectives that have known murder victims within their own family, and it tends to hone what you do a lot more when you realise the impact murder has. Yes, we all say the words murder, homicide, whatever you want to say, but it is the loss of a life, and that's what's tragic here. There were two lives that were lost that day.
To have your loved one disappear and then turn up murdered like that and never have an answer as to who did it. You'd crave justice. Justice is all you've got to hope for.
You don't think about it. Like, life just goes on. And then the 7th of April will come up, a birthday, and then it plays on your mind. Just different little things, but the not knowing, just that to know that person or persons, to get their part of justice.
And pay their dues. That's why we're doing this.
I don't think a day went by that Susan's mum didn't think about what had happened to her daughter. Her mum was devastated when she first reported Susan missing, and that feeling never left her for the 17 years before Susan was identified, and it hasn't left her for the 18 years after.
You can't sit across from people who have lost their children and not feel the immense weight of the what they've gone through. And but for all of us looking on, it is still just like a sad movie. You can never fully experience what they experience. Feeling that feeling every single time they wake up in the morning and remember who they are and what's happened to their lives.
It absolutely ripped the heart and soul out of my mum. I said, "Mum, I promise you, I'll do everything in my power to find answers."
Closure would be the main thing that we're looking for. We need to know why and how. That's the hardest part of all, is the not knowing.
I feel a sort of a long-term concern that we haven't been able to offer a solution. And that does stick with you.
But for the loved ones of these six victims, it is never too late for justice.
If there's no conviction, if there's no accountability, families suffer. They can never really put it to rest.
There are so many cold cases that may be attributable to Milat. These are the forgotten victims, the forgotten families.
It's heartbreaking. Heartbreaking. You want to know?